Senator Johnson, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me today. I know it's an especially hectic time, and I'm extremely grateful for your willingness to speak on these issues.
Thank you for all your work on this important issue. I know my constituents benefit from it.
Thank you. I thought we could get started on the call today by talking about how COVID-19 is impacting survivors, and then explain our support for House Bill 377, and then finally close by talking about the current state of funding for rape crisis programs in Ohio.
That sounds great.
So as I mentioned earlier, I work for a rape crisis program, and I've actually been there for 15 years. I first worked in hospital advocacy and then in legal advocacy before taking on the executive director role. In my time here, we've grown from 4 advocates serving 1 county to 8 advocates serving 2 counties. The legislator increased its focus and really upped its support of our work tremendously since I started. The introduction of the Rape Crisis Center line item allowed us to expand to a second county, and we were planning on expanding further, but recent VOCA cuts reduced our main funding stream, and we had to put a hold on that. Unfortunately, COVID-19 has crippled any hope we had of expanding as we face the daily challenges of providing services. So for certain, we've not experienced a decline in requests, and we honestly struggle to meet survivor needs without being able to give in-person advocacy. We've shifted to tele-advocacy, but that leaves a lot of survivors that specifically don't have access to internet computers or phones without ways to find us or to come in and get services. Unfortunately, we also lack funding to provide all of our staff with off-site connection capacity. To avoid laying off staff and reduce our capacity to meet survivor needs, we've really had to engage in significant innovation, and it's just been a really challenging time.
Can you share with me what that looks like on the ground?
Absolutely. It's honestly been really interesting. When we first were notified of the social distancing recommendations, we really weren't sure what survivor request rates would look like. We predicted there would be an increase because we know crisis situations and conditions often trigger increased trauma symptoms. And honestly, this has been true. I work with a lot of survivors who were in the middle of a criminal investigation or a prosecution, and now those people have no timeline for that process. They don't know how long they'll have to wait to testify in court, and they don't know what the impact will have on plea bargaining or other witness responses. It just creates a lot of uncertainty in really big ways. There are also survivors whose cases happened a long time ago, but are triggered by isolation and need increased support. I think when this period of isolation phases out, we're going to see big increases in in-person advocacy requests. And I just want to add, too, that we're seeing a lot of confusion about whether hospitals are still doing medical forensic exams. We're doing everything we possibly can online to let people know that they won't be turned away if they go to an emergency room, but we really need additional fiscal support to print ads in newspapers, post on billboards, and advertise this at grocery stores and other essential places. We have to think about ways to communicate this because survivors are not receiving medical attention they need in the immediate aftermath of a sexual assault. And if a prosecution takes place later, forensic evidence won't be available.
I appreciate that information. Hospital access is something we have been talking about a lot in our meetings, and this is something I will share with our caucus. Do you think that the social distancing measures are reducing the number of assaults?
That's a great question. We're still seeing high numbers of service requests for sexual violence happening during social distancing. There are a number of reasons that's the case, all really stemming from the fact that most survivors know their abuser. So when we look at the list of essential workers, many, many people in Ohio are still going to work on a daily basis, and that makes them vulnerable to abusive coworkers. Survivors who are sexually abused by a family member are still vulnerable, and many people are just ignoring social distancing directives, which creates other opportunities. Finally, post-rape and independent sexual harassment is still happening online and on the ground. It's part of the culture we live in, and it's persisting in social distancing. And that's why we are hoping to discuss a couple of bills with you that we feel are critical to survivor safety and healing when we open the state back up. So first, we really want to talk about Aaron's Law. Aaron's Law has been introduced in multiple General Assemblies. It was first brought into code in Vermont in 2012, and since 36 states have passed it. So we are one of 13 that does not have it. We are a regional outlier, so Pennsylvania has enacted Aaron's Law, Michigan, Indiana have also done so, New York, Tennessee, ultimately Kentucky and Ohio are really standing out for not having passed this. What the bill does is it addresses child sexual abuse prevention and detection. It was created by a survivor of child sexual abuse and has become law, like I said, in 37 states. Regionally, we don't have it, and I think that is an easy fix because the law is extremely, extremely flexible. The first thing it does is requires age-appropriate sexual abuse prevention education in grades K through 6 and age-appropriate sexual violence prevention education in grades 7 through 12. It requires the State Department of Education to provide free model curricula on these topics and make those curriculas available on their website. And it also finally requires schools to train teachers and other employees on child sexual abuse detection. So it's not a magic bullet. It's not going to automatically end sexual abuse of children, but it's a really strong framework that can mitigate harm as much as possible.
I'm wondering, my wife is a teacher. Will this create additional liability for educators?
That is a wonderful question. It will not. The law does not increase mandated reporter requirements or create any civil cause of action. Instead, it provides additional information and support for teachers who are already obligated to report. So I know a lot of people in our prevention circles that do scientifically based prevention education are already going into schools to talk about these issues and provide education to students. This would allow schools to either have teachers engage in this on their own or engage prevention partnerships with rape crisis programs or statewide coalitions. So it doesn't say specifically that teachers have to be the ones providing the education, but it allows for increased awareness. And I think that a lot of people we've talked to have said that especially younger teachers that are not as comfortable knowing what they're seeing will benefit from having this increased support.
Thank you for explaining that. I actually have a meeting in 5 minutes that I have to get ready for. Thank you so much for your time, and please let my office know if there's anything more we should do.
Thank you so much. We appreciate it, and we hope that you have a great day.